Hey guys, Daniel here. This is another video. My next guest needs no introduction. It's the excellent Gerry Duggan. He's the current writer of the X-Men for Marvel. He's also got to work on so many other comics, some other X titles like Marauders and Cable. You may know him for his work on Savage Avengers, Deadpool, Infinity Wars, Guardians of the Galaxy, Hulk, Nova, Star Wars. We could be here all day. He's done some really great, he's done some great samples of his own stuff, such as Deadeyes, John McCrae and the channel. He's also got to do Analog, which you have right here, which was also drawn by fellow Irishman Dave O'Sullivan. And he has a few more projects. But yeah, Gerry, thank you so much for coming on. How are you doing today?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing great. Like we said, if you do this interview properly, you might get your kids back. You know, you might get your whole family back. So just answer all my questions, you know, to my satisfaction. But yeah, so many different things, you know, to get into. First, let's jump right into it. Just the X-Men, you know. How did the X-Men even come to you? How did you end up working on the ongoing X-Men series for Marvel?
Well, I had the benefit of being in the larger editorial Marvel retreat. And so I got to be, I think I've said this before, House of X and Powers of X's first fan. So I was totally blown away. I knew Jonathan had an X-Men pitch to bring to the room. And it was the most fully formed, sort of most bulletproof idea I'd heard in the room. But then I also didn't anticipate how it oxygenated the room. You know, sometimes an idea, you know, can suck oxygen out of a character or a title when someone's doing it, going, oh, well, we can't do that because they're in space. This was so accommodating. And, you know, that's what created, you know, honestly, out of that weekend, you know, that was where the first ideas on a document called the X-Men Buccaneers were being slotted in there. You know, obviously that would later get a better name, but yeah, right place, right time. I was coming out of space at that time. I was giving up Guardians and was looking for something. I didn't know whether it was going to be at Marvel or something outside of Marvel. And this just clicked. And then obviously, you know, the way that Krakoa went, making it, you know, a permanent fixture in the universe, you know, meant that Jonathan was free to tell some other stories. And so, you know, we outlined a fairly sizable chunk of what would continue in his absence. So, and I hope everyone's enjoying year one of that now.
Yeah, absolutely. And like
Pepe and Marte, right? Or the
not a bad creative team to get stuck with. You know, I'm sure they're like, oh, we have to work with Gerry. But, you know, you just take what you get in situations like this. Like, you know, I had on Chip Zdarsky and he said like almost the exact same thing with Jonathan Hickman and the writers, you know, retreat and stuff like that. So I'm not convinced Jonathan Hickman is real. I've never seen him in the flesh. I don't know. I'm just assuming you're all making up this great one big figure. So unless anyone shows me any proof that Jonathan Hickman is real, I'm just going to kind of remain on the fence on that. Like, is Jonathan Hickman in the room with you right now?
He's with me in spirit.
Isn't he with us all in spirit? That's the same with Chip Zdarsky. He said Chip Zdarsky is in my house somewhere. Once I interviewed him, it's very hard to get rid of him. He just like leeches onto stuff. You have to find him. It's very hard to get rid of Chip Zdarsky. But yeah, so X-Men did issue 7. Is that the most recent issue?
I believe so. I think I have 2 that are at the printer. I think 8 and 9 are there. So 8's MODOK and 9. 9 is Mr. and Mrs. X and Mrs. Mother-in-law of X.
You've lost all meaning of time. Like nothing matters anymore.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, and also it's very difficult. Like usually I'm either months or even years ahead of the story that we're talking about. And then given the COVID problems of what is sliding, like Devil's Reign X-Men 2 from Phil is sliding a week. I don't even, you have an exclusive on that.
Oh, do I? That's not bad. Getting an exclusive here on the channel. I'm just going to sell that article to Bleeding Cool right after this. So that's it. I'm just trying to make money off. This is what it's all about. Just making money off you guys. Like, I didn't even know who you are before this. So I was like, I might be able to make some cash off you. So I assume this is going to be very beneficial for me. The name Gerry.
That's why I like you though. You're honest.
Yeah, everyone exactly. Else is just, that's what we are. We need there's not enough money hungry people in comics. That's what I kind of see. Like, it's all people who just love comics and are passionate about it. And it's like, yeah, but you're not looking at where you can make the money. You know,
are you Jonathan Hickman?
That's the big, no, the real Jonathan Hickman was the friends we made on the way. I'm sure I sound exactly like Jonathan Hickman in that. But yeah, that's why I said, like, we're all Jonathan Hickman in some sense. Well,
Jonathan's very good at what he does. And, you know, Jonathan has, you know, been very successful at finding where the money is. And that's, you know, it can be a marvel to, you know, do that and have the sort of, you know, the bookshelf that he has is yeah, impressive. You know,
is Jonathan Hickman secretly a 14-year-old Irish child? These are the questions we're going to ask on the channel. Like, we've all been thinking it for a while. It's kind of obvious when you look at it. But yeah, no, let me ask you, just like with X-Men, something that's always fascinated me. Like, you look at Marvel, and X-Men feels like its own thing inside Marvel, if that makes any sense. Like, it's completely on fan base. There's this completely X-canon lore and stuff like that. So when you're coming on to the X-Men and knowing the legacy, like Claremont, you know, all these other creators who've worked in it, you kind of have to say, but you have to have a look at the lore. Do you have to do much research? Do you just kind of get into the head? Or because of Marauders, maybe you already knew some of this stuff, but did you have to do a lot of research when you were coming on to X-Men?
Well, I go back and reread things. I'm rereading a couple of stories right now just to make sure that, you know, I have the continuity the way that I remember it, because memory is so fallible. But I've been preparing for this job since well before you were born. You know, I was buying X-Men comics. They were my favorite comics.
Oh, yeah.
Right off the spinner rack, you know, pre-direct market. You know, I knew which...
You'd ride your dinosaur into your news agent.
That's right. But I knew which weeks of the month were likely X-Men months, just, or yeah, X-Men weeks, based on when they were previously on, you know, on shelves. And if you didn't get it, you were, you know, out of luck until you, like, you know, we started going to conventions in Manhattan. You know, this was, you know, at a time when David Mazzucchelli is signing, you know, Daredevil and Batman Year One, just, you know, sitting next to Simons. And, you know, it was a murderer's row of talent at that time in comic books, 86, 87. And many of them were very, very kind to answer questions from me and my friends about how they got in. So that, you know, we do try to pay that part of it forward. The business really hasn't changed. You know, this still the way into comics is to make comics, make your own comics.
Yeah. Oh, wow. So I can't just buy my way in. That's not how it works. Well, there goes my money making schemes. You know, I thought money laundering would be a great way to start, but apparently not. There you go. So
that's what NFTs are for. If you want to launder,
anyone wants to buy my Gerry Duggan monkey picture, that's you, and I'll make some nice crypto off that. I don't know where I can use crypto. Maybe not in my local comic book store. But there you go. I mean, it does have a purpose, though. And no one's allowed to screenshot. No one's allowed to screenshot anything in this interview. Okay, it's my question. Obviously, we'll find you through whatever. But as you can see, I'm so well educated. Don't get me started on that. But yeah, absolutely. So we just touched on like the lore of X-Men. And so do you find yourself, you know, wanting to be respectful of, you know, the Hickman stuff, but also adding on your own stuff? And is it difficult for you to balance that, like throwing in new concepts, but also, you know, continuing some plot lines that maybe were left from before? Or is it kind of just like all smooth for you? Like, do you know how to work with most of it?
I think it's a good question. I think there's enough room. You know, we are always trying to be additive. That was one of Jonathan's big things. You know, we talked about what X-Men Green would be very early on.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, he agreed that it was fun and then just said it's not an... it's not a year one or probably not even a year two idea, because it was, you know, it was mutants finding a way not to be together on Krakoa. And you know, I think I had pitched Planet Size before there was even a great story reason to do it. But that was also Jonathan taking ideas. He's such a good collaborator that, you know, these ideas come up and then he goes, yes, and here's how that would work. And you saw a lot of that in Ten of Swords and some
things.
Thank
you. I'm so glad you like my ideas. It's such an honor for everyone to do it. Yeah. I'm going to keep this joke going on forever in every film now, Jonathan Hickman. Gerry basically confirmed it. Well, I mean, he asked me a question, but if that's confirming it in comic book code, I assume I know how it all works. So yeah, I'll officially be going to the Big Bang Comics and signing autographs to Jonathan Hickman. About 100 euro per signature, I think is fair. I don't ask
for it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's fair. And, absolutely. But yeah, so like, let me ask you this. This is something that like you've done a lot with, but just team books. Like you've gotten to do quite a few team books. Is it harder working on a team book as opposed to like a single character? Because, you know, you could be running a comic, you're like, oh, well, Cyclops hasn't had his moment, or we didn't touch on Jean Grey. And so it's important for you to give each of these characters their moment. And so do you struggle with in the realm of team books to kind of do all that?
Yeah, we team books require a special muscle group in your brain, and they are more difficult to manage. You know, what we decided pretty early on was that every X-Men was going to have their issue where they were the coolest, most important X-Men. And, you know, the team around that character that month would be doing cool things too, or doing things that we needed to further the story, or doing things that they were going to flesh out their own story. And, you know, some of that you're going to see in the back end too. You know, Rogue has her moments, and
nice.
And Wolverine, and I think Sync has had some time to shine, and especially Cyclops with the Cap story and what's going on with Yurik. You know, we're telling a very important. Yeah, there he is,
Captain Krakoa in all his glory. It's not half bad, you know. But yeah, let me ask you this, Cyclops. I asked this of all my X-Men. You know, writers, their mind basically once they interviewed them, you know, it's all in the fine print, you don't have to look at that. But a lot of people have said, no, Cyclops is so boring, he's a Boy Scout. And I think, I don't know, like when you actually read your X-Men, you all do, like you even explore that and stuff like Cable and this, but like, how do you look at Cyclops as a character? Who is Cyclops to you?
Well, he is the X-Men. You know, I think if you have a wrong or bad opinion of Cyclops, you haven't read the Cyclops stories that you need to read.
Yeah.
You know, my love is true. And again, you know, I'm Gen X. Like I was here when, you know, my first X-Men comics were,
Was it just a cave scribbling?
Yeah, that's right. We were shadow puppets. No, but we were watching. You know, I'm sorry. We were reading. You know, the like X-Men and Teen Titans, and you know, X-Men 201. You know, who will lead the team, and will it be Storm or will it be Cyclops? And you know, I didn't have to do anything to make Cyclops cool. I inherited Cyclops cool. So, you know, but X-Men fans, you know, you sort of touched on this a little bit. You know, I don't think Avengers readers really cross the aisle very much. And I think that's true of the Avengers fans. You know, they stay in their own little ecosystems. And, you know, I read everything, but I was primarily a mutant. And so that's why it's such a privilege. And we're trying to have so much fun. Knowing that this is, you know, not a forever job, you know, like I'll tell my story, I'll get to write the end, and then someone else will come in and blow everyone else's hair back. And I'm just trying to enjoy this moment of being the guy in that chair now.
Absolutely. And yeah, you're doing a fantastic job. You know, you're throwing in all this fun stuff. Thanks, like Mutant Resurrection, which has been such a cool, and I can't wait to see that explored more fully. But let me ask you this, you know, do you have plans for the future? Do you know when your run ends, or are you just like, listen, Marvel, as long as you want me to stay, I'll be here all day long, I'll hide in your closets. Like, how long do you plan to work on this?
I don't want to stay at a party too long, but I also have, you know, what I got, the very cool thing about doing this was getting to be a part of, you know, the formative days of Krakoa and going to our retreats and seeing how stories can change based on the world outside our window, based on, you know, what are the other needs of the line? How many books do we need? Where are we telling these stories? I have a really big swing. I have a document that, has gone around now inside the office and outside the office of going, here's some really grade A sirloin, and how are we going to exploit it if this is something we want to do. And CB and Jordan and Tom and the other editors are all behind it. And so,
you're doing a Banshee miniseries. Is this a confirmation?
There actually is. I know you talked to Declan Shalvey. There is a little Banshee in the air. So,
yeah, but it's Declan Shalvey. And it's like, oh, it's Declan Shalvey. You know what I'm saying? And at the same time, it's like, it's Declan Shalvey. There you go. That's what I make of him.
Take what you can get.
When it comes, and Declan, but everyone go pick up Old Dog from your local comic book store, June, something. I don't care when it comes out. It's not my problem. Absolutely. So let me ask you this. You know, out of all the X-Men you've written, do you have a favorite? Or is it like choosing a favorite child, which I believe everyone does have a favorite child? They just can't say it because it makes them look bad. Do you have a favorite X-Men?
I think I went into it as with Cyclops as the number one, but really in the writing of Sync,
great character.
It's about who, you know, has your attention at the moment. You know, I run to the keyboard to write down ideas for stories, and I hope that sort of at least once over the course of the first year, your favorite X-Men on the team will shine through that was my favorite moment or my favorite character. There's so many great X-Men. That's also the reason that the X-Men have so many team books. It's a way of getting as many, because all of these characters are deserving of solos and miniseries and what have you. But the real honest answer is the X-Men line is a fairly sizable chunk of the Marvel pie and of comics in general. And so the way to service those many thousands of characters is to have team books where the spotlight gets to swivel.
Definitely.
I would love a Rogue series. Never know what we're gonna set up.
Exactly. We need that dupe mini series. I believe we're actually getting something like that soon. I believe someone's doing it.
Yeah, you are. You're getting that band back together. So that'll
I
be
tell
fun.
You what, things are coming up good for me. I'll be honest. Like, I'm going on about Banshee and dupe, and it's like, well, listen. There goes my ideas down the drain. Now, that's definitely why CB isn't responding to my emails. That and no other reason. Definitely not because I'm outside his house most days. But that's what you do to break into comics. You know what I'm saying? People don't understand. You have to do that. So issue 8 comes out sometime next month or this month, I think. But we're going to be seeing MODOK. So what made you want to add MODOK into your issue? Do you just think MODOK is a cool character?
I do think MODOK is a cool character. I think all of the Stan and Jack characters are really cool. I think the reason that MODOK is there is MODOK is doing MODOK things. And by issue 9, you'll sort of see how important that is to the Black Hats, to our villains. And so, that's the other thing we haven't really discussed very much is... we need to be good to our villains. And I think we're spending some time in year one really being very good to our villains, and that will pay a lot of dividends on our journey.
Yeah, absolutely. The villains are so cool. So are there any villains from the Marvel Universe we may see appear in X-Men in the sometime near future? Some new characters, some new villains in general?
Well, we have two that appeared in the first issue. We have Fei Long and we have Dr. Stasis.
Yeah.
And we know that they are Orcus affiliated, that they are not fans of mutants. We also know Fei Long has taken it very personally, and he's very raw about losing his Mars dream. He watched the mutants terraform Mars, and so he's clinging to a little piece of it. He's got the moon of Phobos. I loved that Sunfire stuff. That was so much fun. There's more cool Sunfire stuff up on Araco to come. They have plans that they want to execute. It was Jonathan's vision that the X-Men be a superhero team book again, because for much of his tenure he was doing very important story. He's telling very important stories to the ongoing narrative. So, and I'm having a blast. And, he arranged for me to have Pepe and Marte. And so I knew that we were going to hit. And, you know, I tell my story to Pepe, and then he tells that story back to you guys. And, you know, I was never, I was a little nervous about following Jonathan. You know, it's nice when runs the car off the road, but at the same time, you know, I said to myself, these are stories that I didn't think I would get to tell that I get to tell here, and I have Pepe to do it.
Doing a good job keeping the car running. I can definitely say that much. You're doing a very good job. But yeah, for villains like Kevin, I can't wait to see more of Kevin. But also, here's an idea, Evil Banshee. And not Tom Cassidy, because Tom Cassidy's dead to me, because he said mayo for Sam. And that doesn't mean anything to you. Benjamin Percy wrote it, but the Sam Maguire is a prestigious guy trophy here in Ireland, right? We love this. And mayo for Sam is blasphemy, right? Dublin for Sam. So here's what I'm thinking. Me and you, we go to Marvel. I'm not going to ask for much. A 100-page graphic novel called Mayo for Dublin. No, Dublin for Sam. And that's all it is. We can write. I'll let you do all the writing, and I just gave you the concept. And you don't get paid.
It's rare that such opportunities just drop from the sky out of podcasts. That sounds like a hoot.
But listen, does Marvel have 800-something subscribers? No, they have a couple million. But at the same time, I do. And I've interviewed Grant Morrison, which I don't bring up a lot. But there you go. So I think that just gets me a lot, doesn't it? I say that at the dentist, doesn't get me any discounts. But I assume once I say I've interviewed Gerry Duggan, that's when I unlock the jackpot. That's going to get me very far. Let me ask you this. We just touched on there. You know, when it comes to a team book, there's always that core to it. Like, you know, I asked Grant, you know, what's the core of Doom Patrol? And it was kind of like an unfunctional family. And then when you look at characters like the Justice League, they're all people trying to do good. The Suicide Squad, bad people forced together. And, you know, a lot of people have said, you know, the X-Men at a core are a family who try their best. So, like, what do you think X-Men is at its core? Who are these group of characters?
Well, they certainly are a family in the in both the traditional and the not traditional sense. You know, I came out to Los Angeles 20 years ago now and found I was part of a family of mutants from around the world, but especially around the country, where everyone went west and pursued a living that they were not entitled to.
Yeah.
You know, nobody had a diploma that said they got to be the writer of X-Men someday, or that they got to be a film star, or film director, or screenwriter. And so, you know, I have a lot of experience with, blood, family that was not blood. And
I thought you were about to say you just have a lot of experience with blood. And I was like, oh, this seems to be very dark.
That's true. That's true.
How did he get the job at X-Men? I'm thinking. You know, what did he have to do?
Killed Jonathan Hickman.
Oh, no, that's how it ends. Is that why there's a red sniper dot on my head throughout this interview? I always knew I'd go down interviewing. I always knew I'd go down talking about Declan Shalvey. It was how it's going to end. You know? That's how I'm going to leave this time. The same way I came into it. My first words were Declan Shalvey, and my last words will be Declan Shalvey again. But it's almost like, you know, a Shakespearean play, which is only the best word to describe it. But let me ask you this. What's your mutant superpower? What if you could have any mutant superpower, what is it?
I can find parking.
That's what you need
In Los Angeles, that's not that's not easy. So
That's what you need on a team. You know, it's like, oh, come on, you know, Wolverine, we have to go fight this. But yeah, I'm almost finding parking. You know, it's a hard U-turn. We'll get there in a minute. You know, and here in Ireland, all we have is tractors, so that's not a problem for us here. So yeah, we don't have to deal with this. Here's my mutant superpower. Not that anyone asked. I want to shoot water out my butthole and fly with it. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know,
one of those like jetpack guys.
Except water shoots out my butthole. I've brought that up a lot, and I figure one day maybe someone will write a comic about it. I don't care. It's a good concept, I guess. Came to me in a dream, like most great ideas do. But the thing is, like we brought up there, has Jonathan Hickman ever come up with someone shooting water out his butthole? I don't think so.
That's,
we have to ask. Yeah, but yeah, there you go. Yeah.
There's room for everyone's dream.
Exactly. I'm just a boy with a dream to shoot water out my butthole. And occasionally, if you eat a really bad chicken curry, that dream can be achievable. But yeah, let me ask you this. Also, didn't you set an issue of Marauders here in Ireland?
Yes. I think it was late in the run. It was when I wasn't sure which way Tempo was going to go. We were bringing Tempo back. She has the perfect mutant gift for whiskey aging, and you know, was so I think maybe mentioned before we saw her. I wasn't sure whether she was going to go to the X-Men. She was on one of the first lists because I think that's such a cool power set. And then yes, we went to Ireland. I think the Reavers were there, and we managed to get Jumbo in on the action a little bit in that issue.
Yeah, not bad. And I believe you've actually been to Ireland once for a DICE convention.
Yeah, I was there. I've been to Ireland several times. I love Ireland. Nice. I was backpacking there after college and went all around the island into both countries. And I adored it. And then obviously when I got the chance to return for DICE, I leapt at it. So are we doing a DICE? Here, is there a DICE? Is that back?
They don't do DICE now, but Dublin Comic Con is next month. But DICE doesn't, they don't really do DICE the next month. Like they have Ron Perlman coming. So it's not happening.
Oh, cool.
I'm trying to get a press pass just so I can wrinkle my way in and just be like, well, listen, I've interviewed Gerry Duggan. So where do I host the panels? Where does that come in? Is it just right this way or something? But no. Yeah, absolutely. So everyone should go check out that issue. It's so great to see an issue set in Ireland. You know, we should just have a full X-Men book set in Ireland. And here's what I'm thinking. We call it Dublin for Sam. It's just something that popped into my head. I haven't been popping up in this intro at all, but it's what if Dupe was Irish? That's basically my concept. None. It's just him drinking pints in a bar for the whole issue. You're in?
We're getting canceled. Yeah, but I'm in.
You're giving me a poll quote? Are you going to give me a poll quote or what? That's the only reason I'm bringing you on here.
We're getting canceled. Gerry Duggan.
It actually does not get better, any better than that. We're getting cancelled, you know? It's like that's also the title of chapter one. But yeah, let's get into it. Also, another thing I'd love to touch on is we're talking about team books, and you look at your, you know, all like your catalog of comics. You know, there is a few team books, but there's a variety in all the team books. Like, so Savage Avengers and X-Men, they're both team books, but I don't think they could be any further from different concepts. Like when you look at Savage Avengers, you don't see any X-Men traces in it. You look at, well, I mean, besides Wolverine and stuff like that. So let me ask you, is like X-Men kind of a whole new beast to tackle in terms of team book? And like, is it different as opposed to working stuff like Savage Avengers?
Well, X-Men exists in a universe where I've enticed people, my collaborators, into buying into a very large story. You know, structurally, Savage Avengers was very different in that, like, Conan had a certain weight and gravity about him, and not everyone could survive it. So characters go into his orbit, and then some stay, and some are flung out. Like Spider-Man was never going to be able to hang with him. He was never going to. That was, they had irreconcilable differences, but that was what made it so much fun to write that book. It, you know, the thing that I think both books do have in common is there are very strong narrative forces at work for the villains. So Kulangath wanted to wipe out all of life, you know, in a great cosmic horror sense, and really succeeded. And then the Savage Avengers snatched that away from him.
Yeah.
In X-Men, we have villains that are dedicated to cutting out the cancer that is Krakoa, and they are very powerful and competent villains. They have some flair to them. And I can't wait to see who wins.
Neither can I. And also, what I love about, you know, Savage Avengers is that it feels so, I don't know, I think gritty, just as a concept. When you have these characters, get it, it's going to be gritty. It's not going to be a bright, it can be a bright, colorful book, but they're not bright, colorful characters. You know, when it's Frank Castle and Wolverine, who are traditionally these gruff characters and stuff like that. So Did you feel like you kind of wanted to capture that essence of grittiness and darkness when coming out to Savage Avengers?
Yeah, I think Tom had the title and he knew that it could guest or have Conan as part of the cast when Marvel got the license to do Conan. And going back to X-Men, the stories that I remember best, you know, are again stories that I read as single issues. X-Men 205 was the Bernie Wrightson inventory issue with him in the snow. But the ones that really stand out to me as really two of my favorite, it has so much story in it, was X-Men 190-191, where Kulan Goff, you know, took over Manhattan and turned it into ancient Hyboria, and the X-Men and the Avengers had this great adventure. If you haven't read it, it's Claremont and John Romita Jr., and it's incredible. My first question was to Tom at the time when we started talking about Savage Avengers. You know, great, you got Conan, but that's not who I want to talk about. Did you get Kulan Goff? And he said, yes, we can, we're going to. So I said, all right, here's what we're going to do then. If you want to give me the job, we're going to bring that back, but we're not going to do karaoke. He's going to be learning spells by, you know, cannibalism, and he's going to be the worst. And we're really going to, and I explained where I wanted to go with it this time, that he tried to eat Shumagoroth in the past, but it was too big a meal. Now he's figured out he needs sort of more sensible bites. And at that time, I didn't exactly know how to fix it, but I had a conversation once with Mark Waid, and he years ago now, and he made me feel very good about cliffhangers issue to issue, where you don't quite know how you're going to get the hero out of the jam, even though you sort of know the story that you want to tell, you know the end.
Yeah.
And in comics, especially in mainstream comics where you have different artists, sometimes I'm writing backwards, so I will have the end, but you know, some of the day-to-day stuff in terms of the middle, it can be squishy, and that's also in the case of Savage Avengers. You know, that was a book that was paused because of COVID. You know, I wasn't sure that we were going to get it back and get to tell the end of the story. So I'm grateful to the readers and retailers. It's a comic book that like shouldn't exist, and therefore I think feels a little bit more miraculous. I think a lot of people are going to come to it late and go, oh my gosh, I slept on Savage. You know, I was very happy though to be able to write the end. We don't always get to do that in this business, and then just concentrate on X-Men.
Exactly. So, yeah, it's not bad project to project, you know, and like the stuff you got away with in Savage Avengers is outrageous. It's such a fun book. And my boy David Pepose is taking it over. I'm not sure if I pronounced that right. So everyone should go check that out. I don't know when it comes out. Sometime soon, though.
Yeah, sometime like this spring, I think he arrives. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I know
certainly not
about
a bad
it,
successor, I will say. Such a good creator.
Yeah, for sure.
So everyone look forward to that. But yeah, absolutely. So let me ask you this other thing. You know, with Savage Avengers, that is a fun book, and like there is humor injected and stuff like that. And I know, I mean, you look at your work, like Deadpool, sure, like that's one of the most funniest books of all time, stuff like that. Is it hard for you to actually, because it's one thing to be funny, but when you sit down and you say, well, what is funny? And then you have to write jokes and humor. Is it hard for you to write humors in these different situations? Or because you've done a lot of work at Deadpool, and you seem to kind of excel at that. Is writing humor something you struggle with, or?
Well, I thought when I years ago I wrote like on a live daily TV show, and that got me I think working at a pace that you know, when you write live TV, if you have a great day, you don't really have any chance to celebrate it, and if you had a terrible day on the show, you can't really wallow in that because the next day you had another live show. Yeah. So I, you know, I got a good work ethic from that. And I thought I was going to be writing late night TV, and I've written some things, but comics came calling, and that was what my love was. So I was able to sort of approach things the way that a late night writer might, in terms of what we call punch up, because again, I tell the story. Sometimes there's a gag on the page or a punchline.
Yeah.
But really, when the art comes back is when I'll do a dialogue pass for the balloons and boxes. I'm doing that this week for Devil's Reign. And then that becomes what we call punch up, of going, hey, can you beat the joke that's there? And so I think that's what you're feeling. You know, I definitely, you know, when Patton still hosts industry board shows here in town, like me and his brother Matt will go write with him in the week before, and so it's fun. It's again, it's not a muscle group that you always get to flex or be good at, but it is fun.
Oh yeah,
comedy.
Exactly. Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, that's probably what it should be. And I think, you know, you look at Deadpool and like you're working Deadpool with, you know, Brian, it's just some brilliant stuff. And I love the story, you know, you did, but unfortunately you got such a bad artist, like a horrendous artist called Declan Shalvey nominated. And Declan Shalvey, I do hate him, but he's a bit talented, just a bit. Can't stroke his ego too much, but he is okay at drawing some things. Yeah, no, okay, we'll say he's good. But it was called The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly, which was such a great story. And so, like, was Deadpool some of your, like, just first Marvel work in general? Hopping onto Marvel.
Yeah, in fact, Brian and I had made some comics at Image. You really need to make comics in order to be hired to make comics. And,
yeah.
We were under consideration for a Deadpool mini, I want to say almost 5 years before Marvel Now, but at the time the executives at Marvel were just like, look, Deadpool doesn't sell minis. And, you know, obviously that everything changed where, you know, he gave Spider-Man a run for his money in there. But yeah. I have to say, you know, you're supposed to like that Deadpool because of Brian, because of Koblish and Hawthorne and Shalvey and Lawley and all of the other collaborators that we had, you know, that was you know, a dynamite murderer's row of talent that was being really given free rein, and anyone that was in that chair at that moment was going to take a ride. You know, that I was seated before the Ryan leaked the test footage, and then I was there after Deadpool 2. Like, what, you know, it's it's an insane amount of creative energy went into it, and I'm glad it's resonated. Like, I you know, I think I'll be signing Deadpools for the rest of my life, even though I know I'm never going to write Deadpool again.
Oh yeah. Well, I assume a 300, that's kind of you signed off on it, so yeah, I can certainly see that. But yeah, certainly not a bad legacy to have, you know, being known as, you know, someone who's worked in Deadpool. I love when you included him in the Cable series, and him stealing Cable's dead body is just like, yeah, he'd do that. Like, yeah, he'd probably do that, yeah. But so, writing, like, Deadpool for so long, do you just kind of understand that character now? Because, I mean, obviously, maybe...
Unfortunately, yes, yeah.
Do you wake up in cold sweats and you see him at the corner of your bed? Is that basically how it works as a writer?
I still think of ideas that are very character-specific for things that I won't exploit, and then you have two choices. You think about reimagining them, you know, for different characters, or you just say, ha, that's funny, and then you don't do anything with it. And that's usually what happens is you know, I have no interest in going home.
Yeah,
you know, you can't go home, I don't think.
Certainly, I mean, considering that you're working on X-Men, it's not like, you know, you haven't done anything big, because I mean, X-Men's probably one of the biggest, probably the biggest team in the world, and that's like a fantastic. And speaking of big stuff, I think, was Infinity War, like, your only real event for Marvel? Would you call that an event?
Yeah. I think, you know, I was very glad. I approached Guardians, having come from Deadpool, where I thought, oh, I can, you know, outline for years. And realizing, too, that, you know, the economics of it are different. You know, Guardians just didn't move enough units in order to... like accommodate a 3-year plan, but Marvel really moved heaven and earth, and some of our Guardians stuff went into Infinity Countdown and then Infinity War. And having done that now, you know, having done what I've done since then, I think I would know what I would do differently, but I'm very proud of that. You know, and it was the start of thinking about powers and circuits the way that we're still continuing to do.
Yeah, that's like such a big, like, influential part of your work. You can see that there, certainly. Yeah. And so did you do a signing at Midtown Comics in New York to promote Infinity War?
I'm sorry, I don't remember.
I'm pretty sure you did, because I remember I saw, the first time I saw Infinity Wars when I was holiday in New York, and like we were on holiday, and I was like, okay, well, we're going to go into the comic book shop, and we saw a poster about a signing, and with the Infinity Wars poster there. So I was like, okay, well, and it was a week after we left, and I was snapping. I was like, oh, I could have met a comic book writer in New York. And so all these years later, I got a ton of blackmail on you and kidnapped your family. And it does the exact same trick. So there you go, yeah, kids. If you want to follow your dreams, just get loads of ton of blackmail on people. But yeah, so, I mean, I know we're pushed for time. So the last one of the last couple of things I'm going to touch on is, I have it right here. Analog, one of my favorite graphic novels of all time. This is, was this,
thanks, bud.
Was this your first image work? Or no, not your first image work. You just brought up there, you did some stuff with Brian. But was this original graphic novel?
Well, there were a few things that I've done at Image, but that one is very close to my heart. I'm glad you like it. It's really David's book. David O'Sullivan is a wonderful Irish artist.
So good.
Introduced to me by Declan, really the only good thing that Declan's ever done.
Probably, that's true.
it was a story, I think, after it tried to imagine what the world was like by leaping over the quagmire that we're in. I think we are, we were actually in two pandemics, I think history will probably say of this time. We were in we were being made very, very sick by a disinformation pandemic that allowed the COVID pandemic to flourish. And
definitely
Analog leaps over all of that to sort of say, hey, what happens when Facebook ruptures all of its data and all of these companies, because I do believe that will happen too. It happens in drips and drabs, but we're there's no reason to trust these techno oligarchs with our information. And it's a great place to set a neo-noir, put secrets back on paper,
yeah,
and put them into briefcases and away we go. And David crushed it. We're getting back to Analog. David and I are doing
I'm so glad comic, to hear that.
David and I are doing a comic right now that is very different from Analog, just for fun, and then we're gonna pivot back in and bring Analog back. I know how we're gonna do it.
No, I'd love to get more Analog after the end of volume one. We certainly need more Analog. But yeah, so you have something coming up with David. I'll have to have you both onto the channel to promote it then. Doesn't sound half bad.
Yeah, dragging you both. Later this year, you'll probably get a chance to take a look at it. So
sounds really good. It'd be absolutely so. Analog, my next question was going to be if we could have more, but the last comic I want to touch on before we finish up is your very own other Image series, Dead Eyes. It's such a good series. Maybe my first ever Gerry Duggan comic. And
oh, cool.
Yeah, exactly. So it's not half bad, not a bad thing to start off with. And it's a really fun vigilante comic that you got to do with one of my other nemesis is John McCrae. Basically, I'm not a fan of a lot of people. No, John McCrae is brilliant. But so how did Dead Eyes come about? Did you go to John with that concept? Was that something that was bubbling in your head for a while?
Well, I worked in a retail capacity when I got out here at Golden Apple. And so I do think it's a pretty interesting thing to do if you want to make comics, is to also sell comics. And really, the only thing I wanted to do was have of collections of my Image work next to the Deadpool business. There were going to be Deadpool books that I was collaborating on shelves for years. And hey, here's this other thing. It's not Deadpool, but the Dead was very specifically targeted to that readership of going, look how easy I'm trying to make this for the retailers to sell it. And
I never thought about that.
So, and even Analog, I picked the A because it's at the top of the catalog. Retailers, by the time if it's a later in the, you couldn't miss Analog, I guess is my point. But the fun thing about Dead Eyes is it's a very sort of broken down world that we're in, and Dead Eyes is a crook, but he is not always the biggest crook in the story. We have more Dead Eyes. I was looking over the pages last night. We have more Dead Eyes coming. We've been slowed. Unfortunately, John suffered from some long COVID.
Yeah.
So he has good days and bad, but we are bringing that back too.
This is a very good day for me hearing you're bringing back both Analog and Dead Eyes. This is a very good Gerry Duggan day. But yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I remember vividly seeing a page of Dead Eyes on the toilet and thinking, okay, so this is why I love comics. This is what comics can be. But yeah, so is Dead Eyes kind of just your take on... I don't really want to say hero, because I mean, I just kind of always looked at him as some kind of vigilante in a lot of aspects. Maybe he's not, but yeah. Was it fun for you getting to play with that character of Deadeyes?
Yeah, it's, you know, the character of Martin Dobbs has this mask, and it is, as a friend recently described him, he's sort of a crook with good PR. And then he retired because he fell in love and things were okay and things were stable. But now, as he's aging a little bit, and his wife has health problems and the bills are mounting, and, you know, you revert to your old ways, and he gets his buddy Wheels back, and they have a an adventure that goes very wrong for Wheels, and then a fight scene in a hospital that I cooked up that is a lot of fun in that first volume. The second volume is has some true crime in it. It's called Dead Eyes, The Empty Frames. And we're going to be talking about the Isabella Stewart Gardner heist. That was a very Boston crime.
Nice. Will we see more Dead Eyes on the toilet?
Just for you. We're going to do deleted scenes. I'm going to make sure you get them, and then you can add them to your blackmail file.
Beautiful, beautiful. What, how could anyone blackmail you with that? That's your greatest achievement. That's all you'll be remembered for. That's your legacy. Writing.
Character introductions are very important. And so you meet a guy
on the toilet
and struggling against his own remains.
Maybe his superpower is shooting water out of his butthole. That is his, that is that a hidden superpower he has? Because we do see him.
That's your dream. Listen, unless your dream is to put that dream into people.
Yeah, put the concept of shooting water out other people's buttholes. Is wasn't that Gandhi that said that? That's what you have to do. a butthole for water leaves the whole world covered in butthole water. That was one of his more famous quotes. There you go, everyone. Quote Gandhi. There you go. That's a lovely way. No, absolutely. So Dead Eyes, everyone should go pick that up. And of course, Analog, I have right here. The whole time I was scouring for the one page in the book, which was my favorite page. I'll whip it out here. Right there. Such a fantastic page of your man falling to his death.
Yeah.
So cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm so glad you're getting so good. More Analog and Dead Eyes. Do you have any other, like, you know, image or creator-owned series that will be announced in the next while?
Yeah, there's a press release on Monday for an original graphic novel that will be through Image.
Oh, that's
a buddy of mine, Scott Juan Cristiano. He was introduced by a mutual friend of ours. And usually when I'm asked to look at art, like, hey, check out this artist who is not working professionally, it has an unhappy outcome where I have to say, absolutely, this person just needs to work about 1,000 pages out of them and then they'll be a comic artist. But Scott was a fully formed talent, and I gave him about 8 or 10 pages just as sort of a, hey, let's see what the sequentials look like. And he crushed those pages. And I said, oh, we're in business now. We have a small business. Every comic book series is its own little small business. And Scott's going to be a big name.
It sounds fantastic. So everyone, by the time this video is up, you can go see what the announcement is, provided it drops on Monday. So just go into
Jerry. Yeah, check on Nerdist. I think Nerdist has the announcement. So
brilliant. So just go into Nerdist, type in Gerry Duggan, and all will be announced. It's his. He didn't say my name, but yeah, we're doing a Banshee and Dupe miniseries together where he shoots water out his butthole. And now, isn't it nice that I brought this interview full circle by putting all
full
that
full circle? That's right. You're a pro.
We all go through life shooting water out our buttholes at some point. So I don't think we could wrap it up on a better note. Before we finish up, Gerry, are you on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, anything like that?
You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter, but I don't recommend it.
Well, we are Twitter best friends because you replied to my DM, which makes us Twitter best friends.
It's my name on Twitter, at Gerry Duggan, and on Instagram, I'm Dig Duggan, because there was some gentleman in Ireland who parked my name on Instagram. That's what happens.
Exactly.
I can't complain about Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and then lament that I didn't get my name on them.
Irish are known for stealing things, and we are very, very good at it. My last and final question: if anyone's looking to get into comic books, what advice would you have for them as a writer?
Make your own comics. Find collaborators that don't enjoy doing the thing that you do, and they can do things that you can't, and make comics together, and be generous, and be supportive, and be playful, and be kind, and do that many, many times, and eventually you will have a career. Be cool, and mind your online presence. Now you have to more or less say, and just make cool stuff that you want to see exist as a comic book, and don't worry about the other stuff. Don't worry about trying to sell it. Don't worry about this, that, the other thing. Just make a cool comic. It's hard enough to do that once.
Absolutely. And that's advice from the great Gerry Duggan. And, you know, he knows what he's talking about because he just pitched me his Water Butthole comic, which he came up with from out of nowhere. It's a very weird thing for him to bring up just out of nowhere. But listen, we take what we can get. But yeah, so thanks for bringing up Water Butthole.
Right on, bud.
There you go.
It's good to see you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Before we finish up, any new comics you'd like to promote? Anything people can go pick up? X-Men?
Read Indie Darlings, the X-Men.
yes.
Yeah. You can check out my Substack. I'm going to be putting a lot of content up on that.
There'll be a link in the description, everyone.
Yeah. So I'm working on a photo book of 20 years in Hollywood and comics that is coming together really nicely. So eventually, I think that's going to be something I'll crowdfund. This year. So
everyone should go check that out. Before we wrap up, I'll talk to you a little bit about Gerry. Everyone, you can go follow me over on Twitter at SamboGizmo1. Please make sure to like and subscribe. And yeah, if you do have the means, please make sure to donate to the National Deaf Children Society. There'll be a link for them in the description right now. But yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. And yeah, go check out all of Gerry's work. I can't recommend it enough. And remember, it's inside all of us to shoot water outside of our buttholes. I will see you all in the next video. Stay safe, everyone. Bye.